18th, and then there was a letter sent back in November from the zoning officer, basically reminding him of the permit conditions, and consequently, he is here with us tonight. I don't have any complaints on record or any other correspondence relating to the application.
Thank you, Peter. George?
Yeah, I'm sorry John had to come back here in 3 years, but we wanted to be sure you would do your due diligence that you do in your business, and you appear to have. What are those vehicles mentioned in Mr. LaFontaine's letter?
Well, you know, during the winter season, they're snow blowers. There's just a, you know, three different snow blowers.
Inoperable vehicles, so, okay. So they're not there now, John?
Pardon?
They're not there now.
I can't hear you.
They're not there now?
Oh, no. No, there's, I haven't been putting anything out because I didn't have any new product. Now I have zero-turn lawnmowers.
So please note there appears to be unregistered, inoperable vehicles parked in the back. That's what he's talking about.
Oh.
You're familiar with that?
Yeah, there's a 94 Ford Explorer, which was stolen, and it's registered. I just need to get new plates for it.
Okay, so you're going to deal with it, with getting plates, right?
Yeah, I think what they thought I was doing was working on vehicles. I am not.
Okay. No, I hear you.
Okay.
No, they just don't want that kind of stuff in those back areas along the side of Steen, which there are a number of, and you know, so he sees it, and it's not positive. So you're going to get rid of those, and there's no need for us to make a condition in any.
Oh, right, right. The Explorer is actually registered. It's just I'm trying to recover a number plate, so.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
So you'll take care of it as soon as you can.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Hi there. See what else I'm going to say. You've met all the requirements over the last 3 years you've had this and so forth. And are you looking for how long you want it? Are you looking for it permanently and not to come back here or something?
Well, I'd love to visit, but you know, if the council would make it a permanent thing, that'd be fine.
Okay, thank you. That's all, Mr. Chairman.
Other questions of the applicant?
Does the Aaron sign that's on the, does that Ethos sign there, is that part of it or is that just temporary? There's an Aaron sign on the bottom of the three-tenant sign. There's this Aaron sign on each side. Is that?
It's just a little Aaron sign. It's not permanent, no.
No issues with signage, Peter? Is that what you're asking?
Yeah, I was wondering because there's a, it's a.
It's a sandwich board?
It's a nice sign, it has a nice permanent sign, as a three tenants. And then there's an Aaron sign, there's a sign on each side. It kind of wasn't keeping with the whole.
On the directory sign, the freestanding sign?
Yeah, behind the building. Yeah, that directory sign.
Oh, we can check the approvals.
If you can make Aaron's match the rest of it, Aaron's match the rest of that sign. Because it looks like they probably spent a bunch of money on that sign. On the directory sign.
So staff will look at it?
Yeah, we'll have the zoning officer take a look at it.
All right, if there's no other questions, oh, go ahead.
Maybe you can answer this. So we don't get into, like, just so it stays with him, so like, let's say if there's another tenant that comes, how do we do that so it just stays with?
Mm-hmm. You can't.
So then we have to maybe come back in a couple of years or something like that, just so it's the different automotive guy moved in there.
So is that different enough if it's automotive, or would it have to be specific enough to be a small engine repair facility that replaces him?
I think that historically the testimony specifically related to mowers and snow blowers. So, I think maybe just to clarify, if there's going to be a motion, that would. If you're just concerned about future auto dealers, but the auto dealer would have to come back through a separate process anyway. So
I'm talking about anybody else. What he's doing is established and all that. Just so the next whatever company comes in there.
Yeah, just be more specific about three units of what, so that it isn't like three Hummers parked out in front of the building.
Yeah, or used appliance store or something like
hot
that.
Hot tubs.
Yeah, perfect. Exactly. Mannequins.
So this is, George?
Further question. I'd like other commissioners to comment on how long we should approve this for, or should it be a permanent thing?
I think that we ought to put a time limit or some restriction, just so that in the event the business is sold, I'd be reluctant to have this run with the land so it's permanent. We've had a good track record with you. We appreciate that. The town does. But who knows what the future is going to be. At least we can keep control of it and have so that it's a more limited thing. Sorry to have to ever come back, but I think we would. It's better for us.
Dan, what's the difference between this and other retail establishments, such as the hardware store nearby, for example? We don't put a time limit on them. And they have similar things.
You know, I can't answer that, only because I haven't been here long enough to be involved with all those other applications. So it's not fair for me to answer that question. I'm looking at this particular application.
Yeah. I mean, personally, you know, you asked the question, how do we all feel about it? I was going to talk about it after the close of the hearing, but it sounds like the applicant is willing to go anywhere with it. The longer, the better. That was kind of his response, right? I'm kind of siding with some sort of control. Can you offer us what might be convenient? Like, for instance, do you have a lease or something that we could tie? Like, are you?
If I need to come back next year, it wouldn't be a problem.
We're not talking about a year. We're talking about, you know, whether
3 years.
Five years. Actually, when I got to notice this December, I called Peter, and he says, "Well, as long as there's an application in force, you know." Yeah. You could put something out. So, but I didn't have anything to put out because I was selling more than I could.
Do you have a lease period at this point?
Pardon? I mean,
are you tied into a lease for, say, 5 years or anything like that?
I just have an open lease with.
Okay. So, okay. Well, I think we can deal with it after we close the hearing, sort of thing, and figure out something. Is there anybody in the public who wants to speak on this? It is a public hearing. All right, seeing nobody, can I have a motion?
Oh, there was just one more question. If I could just add one more unit, it was for three, if I could put four out.
Oh, the list, a little twist at the end.
Snuck it.
That's a third parking space? No,
no parking space.
He mentioned it before.
It's just that there's different types of equipment, and you know, I don't want to put three of the same tractors out. I might have a zero turn and a tractor and another piece of equipment, but.
So I apologize. You apparently said something right over my head. All right. We do have fair enough. So we did have a motion, right?
Second.
And a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Very good. So does somebody want to make a motion?
Make a motion to approve application 1937-17Z. For outdoor retail display at 526 Silestine Highway with the following stipulations. There shall be on display no more than four units at any time, four units of yard and or power equipment at any time. Two, the display shall be permitted for a total of 12 weeks per calendar year as determined by town staff. And three, disapproval for a period of 5 years.
I'll second the motion.
Okay. Thank you, Tony.
I feel that he doesn't need any time frame, but 5 years is more than reasonable, and I'll go along with that.
Yeah, I mean, I sort of agree as well, because, I mean, there are all these other conditions, and if he was violating them, you know, that's the control we have is enforcement rather than, you know.
But I wouldn't want to put these conditions on every business going in the Silestine Highway. That's what bothers me a little bit. But especially where he appears to be a good owner and tenant in there. But, you know, 5 years is reasonable at this point.
All right. 5 years is the motion and the additional unit? Any further discussion? All right. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Very good. Good luck.
Thank the board.
Take care. Next item on the agenda, 4.2, is a public hearing for application 1938-17-Z. Matthew Donovan seeking a special permit for the creation of a parking lot, expansion of outdoor storage and display areas, establish a showroom and hoop houses that exceed the maximum height at 1943 Berlin Turnpike. This is Cedar Mountain Sona Mulch. Is the applicant here? Could you join us, please? If you would be kind enough to introduce yourself and take a moment to explain the project, and while you're setting up, in case there's somebody else who wishes to speak on this is a public hearing, so the way the process works, even though the last one was, I'll take the moment to tell you. After the applicant speaks, we'll ask questions. When we're comfortable, we'll turn it over to the public for public input. Then we'll go back and talk to the applicant about some of the thoughts that we've heard from the public. If, in fact, we're comfortable with the input that we've received, we could close the hearing tonight and act on the motion. Alternatively, if there's more information to be gathered, we could extend it beyond tonight's hearing and deal with it on another night. But that's kind of the way the process works with the applicant.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is John Artise. I live at 32 Bennett Avenue in Cheshire, Connecticut. I am employed by Matthew Donovan and Cedar Mountain Stone and Mulch under the heading of business development, so this qualifies as business development this evening. So I'm here to speak in support of special permit 1938-17-2, which includes permission to use a new building that's located on the property. In addition, we are seeking approval for outside sales of more than 14 days per section 5-3-A-10. Approval for exterior storage without visual screenings per a granted ZBA variance 6185-17. Also, that would fall under section 5.3.A.12. And lastly, we are seeking approval for two hoop houses year-round use, not to exceed 26 feet in height per section 5.3B. As I begin, I just want to thank Peter Gillespie and his staff, Denise and Justin. They were very helpful in us trying to put together this presentation for you this evening. We're here trying to improve the overall experience for our customers, for our employees, and for the community and the neighbors. Since its beginning in 2004, Cedar Mountain and the owner Matthew Donovan have been a good neighbor and responsible community member. Matthew's contributed to many local events, including the annual fireworks, project graduation, in Little League. We're currently an active member of the Chamber of Commerce. We've submitted a plan that you folks have in front of you. I will caution it is lacking in several areas. We met with staff yesterday at 11 o'clock in the morning, and it looked like my old homework assignments. It had a lot of red marks on it. So a lot of that has been duly noted, and we know we've got some improvements we need to make to that. But we want to start the discussion and begin the process. Our intention is to discuss the parameters of the project to comply with the directions and the standards and the suggestions that are made. Cedar Mountain's a seasonal business. Typically April to September, the busy season, we're open 7 a.m. to 5 p.m. and we employ roughly 16 to 18 people. As the season winds down, beginning in September or October, we cut our hours back from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. We employ 8 to 10 people. December through March is a different type of selling season for us. We sell winter bulk supplies. We employ 3 people at that point, and we're open from 8 to 4 in the afternoon. We do open in some instances earlier, depending on severity of storms and the timing of storms. We're a materials yard. For those of you that aren't familiar, sand, salt, decorative stone, concrete products, natural stone, things of that nature. We've grown quickly since 2004, and we feel that shows that there's a need for our products and services in the community. We're located in a highly visible location. We're surrounded by the Berlin Turnpike, Route 175 and Russell Road. We currently operate on 3 acres of property. So we're looking to move our sales office from its current location to the front of the property within building lines. We feel it's important for our safety is number one, employee safety and customer safety, and also it'll tie into improvements, other improvements we want to make on the property, including displays. Our hope is to have the special permit approved through whatever process that takes. We do intend to come back with a comprehensive plan later in the year that'll include two abutting properties that we own, trying to make those two properties one site. At this point, I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you, George. I won't start off with you. I'll start off with him. You, Peter, do you consider this an adequate application for approval?
As the applicant indicated, we met yesterday for a significant period of time going over the application, the issues that are still outstanding, and the need to upgrade and improve his site plan. So as we speak right now, no, the application is not complete. There are issues outstanding, but I think you heard from the applicant their willingness to, I think, come back with a resolution or an attempt to resolve those items that are still outstanding.
Why doesn't he rescind the application and apply again, and we wouldn't charge him for the second time around? I looked at this, and I've been over to the site, clearly walked it, but there's so much more there than what I saw 10 years ago when I last looked at this. And your previous owners, and I think yourselves, you may be moving in the right direction, but I see nothing in front of me that I feel I could approve with all the conditions and problems that are cited by the town staff in their backup memoranda. And John Miller's plan over here lays out a general outline, but I can't follow it as to what you're going to be doing and how you're going to be screening and how you're going to be meeting the runoff issues. I don't like the idea of the millings. I want to see some pavement. And the owner walked with me yesterday. I shouldn't have been talking to him, but he had wanted to talk to me, so I listened to him. But the point is, he tried to make a case that the millings do firm up and are as good as asphalt pavement, for example, through the main right-of-way and things like that. There's a lot to be done in there. I don't see on the plans where you're showing what's going to be done for the future, because the plan is for what you're doing or what you're going to be doing down the road. And I would have a great problem trying to approve this. I really would. I really didn't appreciate our Zoning Board of Appeals in the past. I didn't look at those approvals very clearly or in detail, and that wasn't in front of us. But some of those things probably shouldn't have been done. Also, you purchased additional property next to it, and I see the owner trying to work with that, and that's good. That's all good. I wonder about those hoop houses, how big they are, and it's in the neighborhood. I get concerned the screening is dead out front. This is the entryway to our town of Wethersfield, and I feel very strongly that this doesn't represent the entry to Wethersfield that we're trying to propose. Wethersfield is fine, and other points of entry are reasonable in some locations, but this is just not adequate at all. And you've got a good location there, there's no question about it. Traffic is awful out there on the Berlin Turnpike, especially at commuter times, coming home at night. It's awful when I went out there. And I hope the DOT can do something with that. A double lane in there or something else is definitely needed. But I'm going on too long.
All right, so let me just point out to the commission and to the public that there are letters in the file or memos in the file. First, there's a rather extensive one from Peter to us describing the proposed activities, et cetera, and some background. And a list of comments. I'm going to ask you a question on it, but I'll just run through some of the other stuff here. There is a memo, by the way, and that one is dated April 3rd. There is a March 31st memo from the town engineer going through seven comments on the plans. There is obviously the memo from the applicant. Other ones of significance are a series of letters, memos from the zoning enforcement office, talking to current conditions that are beyond what's allowed and offering citations and enforcement orders. There are several starting in, I think they start in April of 16 and they go through the end of the year. And I guess part of that culminated in this zoning Board of Appeals process. So if I could just ask a question. Oh, right, of course. And then there's two more memos that came in. First is from the town of Newington. The planning staff actually prepared a memo in opposition to it. And they specifically reference our sections 8.1, 8.2, 8.8, and 8.9, and the subsections therein, and offer that in all cases this application, and actually I think they suggest that the current situations are incompatible and not suitable to the location. So if you haven't read that one, please take a look at that. That's Newington. And then there is another letter that came in, I think, yep, dated today, from a nearby property owner, Pierrero LLC, with a number of questions, some of which I tend to agree I will be wanting to ask as well. Have you seen?
I saw that. That came in at about 3 o'clock today. Yeah, but yes, I do have a copy of that. Yeah.
But certainly some of the questions on there were on my own thing. So Peter, you marked up with the applicant their plans. Looks like an old high school project. I get it. Are those the 12 comments that you've had here kind of highlighted on the plans?
Primarily, they were also some of the town engineer's comments. So it was understood that obviously, since the meeting was yesterday, there would be no opportunity for Close, Jensen, and Miller to come in with a revised plan. So we indicated that it was very probable that this hearing would be continued. And I'm not sure they've had a chance to talk to Close, Jensen, and Miller as to whether they can address all of those items before your next meeting, which I believe is April 18th. So that's probably, you know, the next sequence of questioning, at least as to the timeline.
Of
the future meetings.
So could you remind me, because I simply can't remember, the last time we saw them, they were here to break up the property into several
in 2014, correct. There was a subdivision of three lots, and as was mentioned in the presentation, there are two adjoining homes. There was a barn on one of them, which has since been demolished.
And the second parcel is shown on the plans. The third is not.
Let's take a quick peek. It might.
That's correct.
Yeah. You're probably correct.
It's kind of like notched out of it, I think.
Yeah.
Okay. We approved in the past this one here. That house should be demolished.
That's number two. That's 137, right?
Yes, it's probably the one at the end.
Right. So the third one is off of the
plan. You can see the bottom at the bottom right hand corner. That's the
so the application refers only to 143 and has nothing to do with 137 and whatever the third
1943. Yes,
I'm sorry, 1943.
Yep.
Okay.
Was that supposed to be demolished?
No, George. When I said demolished, there was a barn behind this house that was accessed off Russell Road back in here that was right. was demolished last year, maybe, or a year before?
Probably 2 years ago. It was ready.
Did you buy that property?
The barn was about to fall down. Yes, sir. I'm sorry.
When did you buy that piece of property?
2014.
And then 33. Okay. Thank you. Okay. So
you demolished. Okay.
So there's two things that I'm not clear of when I read the documents. The zoning enforcement officer has referred to the fact that a parking lot was required under the earlier proposals, and I'm not remembering, where was that parking lot supposed to be? Is it in the same location it's being considered now?
Yes.
Is it is? That yes. Was all part of the original? So when they propose a structure, what I'll call to the south end near the entrance driveway, right, and keep the commercial or retail part of it up toward the front of the site, that was all part of the original one? So that's just restating that?
It was part of a couple of previous applications, but yes, in general, that is the location for the, let's call it the public aspect of the business.
Okay, and what did the Zoning Board of Appeals just offer or just provide this applicant?
So the ZBA in January, I think it was, granted a variance to, we have requirements that prohibit the storage of materials in certain yards. So they granted a variance to that. We also have a requirement that with outdoor material storage, that there be full screening. They granted variance to that.
And those are rights that the applicant has under our zoning as it applies, as long as you do the screening and that stuff is not there, or were those other conditions that this commission had?
No, they are part of your present zoning regulation requirements. So the applicant,
we can't override those, Peter, right?
No, you can't override that decision. So
we can't require any kind of screening.
No, I wouldn't. I didn't say that. You can't override the fact that they granted a variance. The variance runs with the property, but you can attach reasonable conditions to your application. They are asking for the storage of materials. I have talked to the applicant about that, and they seem willing to come back with a plan that might address those issues. So I think that is my opinion that needs to still be done regardless of the ZBA's actions.
Okay. Just to say, what we're looking at here is a special permit. I know you've been there for a number of years. Number of applications, there are allegations, I don't know, that applications were granted with conditions weren't met, and the purpose of this is to consolidate everything and correct or perhaps alleged wrong that has been going on. I'm looking at it as a member of this commission that because you're asking for a special permit, it's as if you didn't exist and we're starting all over again. That's my feeling.
I agree.
And we're looking at this as if you're just coming to town and want to open the business. And I want to look at it as to what the plan is under the conditions for our special use, its compatibility with the neighborhood and all those other conditions that are there. And I think that although I am a proponent of business expansion in the town, and we want you to do well within our zoning regulations.
Sure.
And I think the onus is on you to come back with a plan, given its location, the fact that it is the gateway to Wethersfield, and we want to protect that gateway to attract other people to town, that you need to comply to come in within those specifications for a special use. And we don't see it now. So the question is, do you withdraw the application and come in? Or we just can't, not in favor of just continuing perpetually, an application, that it stays on our books and you come back in 2 weeks from now, you're not ready. And I understand it takes time to put this together. But the point is that we're not ready to, as far as I'm concerned, we're not ready to act on this, not even close to being ready to act on this application as it sits today.
If I may.
Satisfy us as if you were a brand new business coming into town for the first time.
Yeah, if I may, Mr. Orgel and Mr. Silver, you guys both make good points. I understand that. But we have been there since 2014, and we have been a good neighbor. And some of the problems or conditions are not overt. We're over the property line on a few things. I mean, we are willing to comply. The reason we're here is to get reorganized and in compliance and continue, the prosperity that we've had. We understand that. One of my responsibilities is to get us back on course and make sure we comply with the regulations. That's why we're starting the process. So I appreciate your comments, but you know, we do have a history of, as a good business partner, or as a good establishment there over the last, and I'm not asking for anything special for that, but I just want to make the point that, you know, we are trying to comply.
Well,
and work along.
That's the point. I want to see you comply. I'm not trying to say that this business shouldn't be there. Absolutely false. I want to see you do well there. But like every other application, it's got to meet the criteria, you know, of our ordinance. And
okay. Yeah, I just really want to summarize what I think I understand about the application in and of itself, and that is that this application is not asking for anything more than you are already currently doing or have prior approvals for.
The only exception to that would be the primary reason I'm here this evening is to try to get permission to have that new office operable. There's a new building on the property. If I can give you a little bit of history on that. That was our building. It was located on a leased piece of property in Manchester, Connecticut. The lease was over. That business closed. We had to move that building. So we at our expense, we brought it to Wethersfield. Never used it. You know that we have to go through the proper channels to get it up and running. That's what we're trying to do. That's why that's there. But that lends itself to cleaning up the operation, adding to the safety, adding to the look of the yard, adding to the, you know, beautifying it. So that's the first step of trying to get things started.
So the disconnect I heard there was, I just heard that the parking that's proposed up in the retail area up toward the front of the site, and I hope you see it and understand what I mean by up toward the front, near the driveway. The parking was already part of a previous approval. Was the building not part of it? And
Not this building, not this location. This parking lot that you're seeing on the plan is also not the same dimensions and number of parking spaces as previous approvals. At one point, the parking lot did exist and was taken up by storage of material over time. So this business, as was indicated in the presentation, is seasonal in nature. At the beginning of the year, they bring in all of this stock, which then gets dispersed during the course of the season. So what you're seeing now, I'm assuming, is probably absolute worst case scenario.
We are overflowing with inventory because of the spring season. And one thing we do as businessmen is we'll purchase in the wintertime in bulks to have it ready, right? So we get different advantages for buying in bulk and bringing it in early. And so, yes, we are bursting at the seams in terms of inventory today.
So the other part of this is the enforcement action. Mr. LaFountain directed him to come in with an application to legitimize what's going on out there. To the point about withdrawing it, coming back, we've been very much willing to work with the property owner here to get this situation in front of you. We have not been pressing them for time. So time is not necessarily an element here. If the applicant were to withdraw the application, work out the issues and come back with a plan, I don't think staff would have any objections to that. Take as much time as necessary to come back with a plan that's acceptable to the commission. Once again, that's up to the applicant. If you want to withdraw this, as was indicated by the commission, we probably wouldn't charge you another application fee. There might be a nominal fee for some of our processing and legal requirements, but so that's certainly an option. As I mentioned earlier, I don't know if you've talked to Close, Jensen, and Miller, and whether they're going to be able to come back in, you know, basically next week with a plan that addresses all the things we talked about. So that's probably the the $64,000 question. And if that isn't the case, then maybe the applicant should withdraw it and come back in with a more complete application. And we will continue to work with them on the enforcement items.
The only thing I'd add to that is that, you know, we shouldn't give an unlimited time for the applicant to come back to us. I mean, we want to give them a reasonable time to do it. But if we're going to delay enforcement of the existing regulation, we're doing that to assist you.
Sure.
But there has to be, should be some kind of a limit that an application has to come back at within a certain period of time.
Jim, I apologize. I didn't come back to you.
No, I agree 100% with Dan's saying. And I think what Dan is saying and what Peter's saying, it'll help us. And I think it's going to help your cause to very clearly spell this out and make it actually quicker. But Dan, I agree with you that if they aren't moving in a positive fashion, staff will know that very readily, then the enforcement is the enforcement. But as long as they're progressing, and I don't see this being ironed out in 15 minutes by any stretch of imagination.
No, we would, you know, I did speak with Close Jensen Miller as soon as I left your office the other day, Peter. You know, we would like the opportunity to get the plan corrected within the next week and get it resubmitted to you to continue the hearing. I would prefer to go about it that way. I mean,
So in terms of a process, I honestly believe you could probably withdraw it anyways. We could just leave the hearing open, I'm sure, process-wise, and if you chose to continue it, that's fine. We'll see you here 2 weeks from now, and if at any point you decided to withdraw it, you could probably just do that with Peter, right?
And I also see, I mean, he's also in a tough situation because he's trying to build inventory for the season, and now his season just got mudded out, so now his season is prolonged. So you have inventory that's sitting there probably longer than usual. And also you have you're the only operation of a unique operation, a commercial operation, where I understand the millings because he's running machines around his yard so he can pave his yard, and then you have to pave that every other month with running a loader through that yard and everything else. So it's just the nature of the scenario. And retail customers who go in there, it's not like you're going to Home Depot and getting a shopping cart full of mulch. This is a more commercial operation. So I get there's different nuances that go. So the plan, the buttoned up plan, more buttoned up, and I agree, maybe keep it open.
I mean, basic driveways or parking for people coming into the site, you know, to buy, shouldn't be there?
It shouldn't be there.
Is that what you're saying?
If you choose to go to that type of establishment to procure bulk stone, bulk mulch, I don't know. Just generally the kind of, I don't know their customer profile, but just how they run things there when you're getting loaded with a machine, a payloader or a bobcat. Yeah. I don't know if you pull in with your Yaris and expect your trunk to be filled with a Cat 980 loader.
We're probably 60% contractor, 40% retail. So there is quite a bit, a majority of the loads go via bobcat or in a bucket and go to the back of a vehicle. But we do understand that right. Along the lines, if we're going to have an office, we do need a parking area and you know, with handicap accessible, all those things. We understand that. And part of the plan is if we segregate that office, it helps for safety. It also helps for retail. It helps to meet some to comply with the things that we have to. So my
only point about the timing was that he doesn't need to make a spot decision about, rescinding the application. You can leave here tonight and decide that later with your owner.
I appreciate that. Yeah.
A
couple other observations or questions. John, can you tell me your name again?
John Artize. Artaiz.
And you're representing?
Matthew Donovan, who is the owner of Cedar Mountain Stone and Mulch.
Which is also known as 1943 Turnpike LLC.
Yes, sir.
And is he the sole owner of that limited liability corporation?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, and you've been in business since, you said, 2 or 3 years?
No, we've been at that location since 2004.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you will be able to attend to these three zoning violation or concerns at the next meeting if that comes through?
The three that that we highlighted?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
Could you tell me what the RC zone is for this location? And do you think you're satisfying? And I'm asking this question because we spent almost 2 years on the 10-year master plan of conservation and development. And I was in the impression this would be an isolated type business, quite surprised that it's expanding further to this side with these three parcels. You're paying almost $49,000 a year in property taxes. So obviously you're a good taxpayer. I've noticed that you have done some outreach with the community and have done a good effort. I visited your facility and have used your product. But my bigger concern is related to the overall long-term picture. Is it a commitment that you're making to keep this type of product and this type of business on this property I ask that question for the overall long-term plan, but more importantly, in the highest and best use for this facility. There's over $1.2 million of appraised value at this location that, in my mind, based on changes that have occurred in Newington encroaching through Wethersfield, it's being underutilized. Maybe you don't have an answer to that, but having been a citizen here for my whole life, knowing that we are focusing on the highest and best use in generating taxable revenue, inventory is not generating revenue. This potential here could be utilized for a 400 or 500% more in property tax. And I just want to know your observations on that. And I probably should have asked this first. Are you representing this as a lawyer or an economic development or an agent of record? What is your history and your background focusing on this application?
Well, my history is I did business with Matthew Donovan for about 10 years. I was ran a paver manufacturing plant in North Haven, Connecticut. I was the general manager there. So we became close during doing business. And Matthew always impressed me with the way he ran his operation. I left that company and went to work for him. I am not an attorney. I'm just here representing Matt as one of my job responsibilities to help him. He hired me to help him grow his business and control his business. He's doing a lot of different things, and so that's my responsibility. Long term, it's hard to truthfully answer for you know what his plan is. What I see day to day is a desire to grow that business. We're looking at all the different lines that we carry, the profitability in those lines, adding different lines to it. You know, the improvement of the office, the improvement of displays. It's all to build the Cedar Mountain business. So I believe that's truly, you know, in his heart and in his blood, if you will, and he wants to stay in that business.
Keep it clean, proper.
Keep it clean, proper. It's expanded greatly. It's grown quite a bit. It's been very successful.
It's a very,
and so, and he's had, as a one-man band, a hard time to handle that. You know, in my experience, although it doesn't apply here to what we're looking at tonight, I've been to hundreds of stone yards that are a complete wreck and a complete mess and completely, you know, undesirable. But they're busy. It's a bulk business and it's a, you know, it's a dusty business. We're trying to improve that. And
with the assemblage of the other two parcels to the north, do you think the product will remain about the same?
And we do that. So that'll help facilitate perhaps a warehouse. Okay, so that we can put more things under lock and key. We can have some dry storage. We know we desperately need, our target market is female, 35 to 65. We need inside showrooms. We need a place to have a landscape architect. We need, you know, we want to do a, have a run of first class operation there. Outdoor living is growing immensely, right? As it's just more and more things are coming outside. Appliances, TVs, life is coming outside. So it's a growing business, and we want to do it properly.
What are your observations about the Newington comments and some of the specifics within our zoning regulations? Do you have any? Have you read on that, or do you have any expertise on that? That's where I was going.
You know, right around the corner from us, there's a piece of property there that has not been developed. That's supposed to be developed. If you took a look, I've got pictures with me, but I don't want to go that route. There's I believe that's in worse condition than our property, and it's a vacant lot. The silt fences are down. There's equipment all over the place. There's sewer pipe all over the place. I don't think it's justified. Now, we want to be a good neighbor, and if it's a condition of putting up some screenings on that property, even though we don't have to, we'd be happy to do that. We're not going to be unreasonable. And if on the Russell Road side, we need to put some things there, that's completely understandable. One of our advantages is the Berlin Turnpike site, right? We've got a great opportunity to show the public what we're doing there. So that's why we want the new office and some new displays and some colorful umbrellas and some furniture and some ornamental nursery products so we can attract more business that way.
And if we have this hearing a couple of weeks from now, you'd be able to give us possibly that long-term agenda inclusive of the assemblage of the other two parcels, or is that too far reaching?
I think the other two parcels is, you know, in speaking with council on that, that's a little too far reaching. I can address it with Matthew and council and see if we think we've got enough time to make that run. we can, you know, we're not trying to hide that fact that we want to make it one parcel.
That's a future thing here.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Well, you might be able to suggest that in any application.
That was our thought. We want to clean up where we are, get it straight, let you know our plans exactly, and then come back to you, whether it's 6 months to expand.
I know we have facilities like Bob's Nursery and a variety of other low-profile type utilities on the Wethersfield section, but it was only 20, 25 years ago where the Berlin Turnpike in Newington was full of fruit stands and drive-in movie theaters. And the tax base there has grown dramatically. And again, I might call that as an observation, maybe a distraction, but it's clear that you are paying your property taxes. You're paying close to $50,000 a year. The assemblage issue, I think, is significant. Expanding the property is something we need to be sensitive. But I read through the Newington observations, and I wouldn't say they're right, but they're definitely not wrong. And I respect some of their observations.
Okay. Based on, you know, in there they mentioned blight. And, I mean, the impression there is that it's a messy or a dirty situation, or there's garbage or you know, it's and that's not the case, right? We've never been cited for that. We've been cited for encroaching on property lines, but not for, because of an expansion of business, but not for not running a neat, clean operation.
The difference is now you're coming in for a site plan, not for a site, for a special permit use. And we have rules for approval of we have to take certain things into consideration in order to grant a special permit.
Well, I completely, I understand.
For, so it wasn't, it wasn't enforced because they couldn't.
Sure. And we're of the ilk, we want to comply, we want to get it organized, we want to straighten it out, we want to be a good citizen when it comes
to
that.
The only other suggestion is, as far as the other two lots, you may be far-reaching, but if you brought back a plan which was approvable to this commission for a special permit, couldn't guarantee you what's going to happen to approvals for the other lots, but if you came in all at once, even if you didn't develop it at once, at least you'd have, you know what you can do and for the future. It's just a suggestion.
I'll talk to the talk to the parties involved, and we'll see what we can do.
Okay. I'd like a little more enhancements to the Newington observations. I think they're sound. You have a 360-degree property there with a lot of visibility, a lot of traffic flow. Traffic count is amazing, and I think it's a diamond that's underutilized.
Okay, thank you.
Just sharing that with my members.
Okay.
I guess my thought is that I'd rather continue this one, and if they're ready in 2 weeks, fine. If they're ready in 4 weeks, fine. Rather than just kind of let them withdraw it and let it slide on.
Thank you.
The question I had, Peter, is what specifically are the violations that are the subject of the enforcement?
In general, much of the outdoor storage, stockpile, whatever you want to call it, has expanded outside of historical approvals into areas that weren't approved, closer to Russell Road, closer to the off-ramp, spilling over into the right-of-way. So that's one of the bigger items. The parking lot obviously was never constructed.
Trees are dead.
Yeah, the screening that was there were two different screening plans approved with previous applications, which either have died or were just buried with piles of stone or whatever might have happened over the intervening years. So it's just a general expansion of the business into areas and non-maintenance of conditions that were previously applied. So,
right. Is the town okay with non-bituminous?
I pointed that out in my comments. You have a kind of a, maybe flexible is not the term, but your regulations don't specifically require bituminous concrete. They say a dust-free. So there have been instances where gravel, peystone, and other materials have been used for parking lots, primarily in Old Wethersfield. So you've used that regulation to be a little bit flexible. Whether millings are something we want to, you know, start allowing, I guess is a debate you're going to have, but nevertheless, it is a product that this applicant has available to him and has used it. I think also to Jim's point about the nature of the business, bituminous throughout the majority of the site is probably a bad application.
I don't recommend
even maybe if, and maybe also even in the, you know, the public areas. So I think that is a serious conversation we need to have.
I just think as soon as you start putting bit down, you start flooding the whole area because this is.
And I don't, you know, it's unless it's designed in a, you know, a super way, it's going to, you know, heave and fro with the heavy materials. Yeah. And I think this site also historically might have had a water body right in the middle of it that's been filled in over the years. If you look back at some old old mapping and photography, so I'm not sure what the, you know, the underlying soil materials actually, you know, consist of. So it may not be the best solution. And but I think that's something we did point out in our meeting that they're going to go back and see. Some of it may have to be paved or
stone. There's probably a solution in between, right?
Yeah. Just because we need some handicapped accessibility. So I think the applicant's willing to consider all that and come back with
a solution. We're continuously getting 48,000-pound deliveries, you know, tractor-trailer trucks with natural stone or pavers or, you know, through that yard. So there's a lot of heavy weight that comes in there.
And you might not have to do the access driveway, but if you peeled off to the right, if you come in the driveway and it's gravel...
It's also a very steep slope.
Turn right into the parking lot that's up against the building that's set aside for the ADA compliance issues. You could probably get away with something. I think it's pretty clear that this is going to be continued, but there are people here in the audience, and I want to try and give them the opportunity to speak to this. So would you cede the mic, and we'll have some people come up? Thank you. Please join us.
Good evening. I'm Craig Miner. I'm the town planner in Newington, and I am here tonight representing the Planning and Zoning Commission. Mr. Ortiz is correct. The property on the corner of Russell Road and East Cedar Street in Newington is unsightly at the moment, but it is a construction site. There is an active site plan that's on record, and that's why it's as unsightly as it is at the moment, because it is being developed. In contrast with the applicant's request, which is to be allowed to have an unscreened yard of construction materials in perpetuity with effectively no screening. Now, I know that the commissioners have the letter that I sent, so I won't take up your time reading it, but I do want to reference two specific sections in your regulations that the town of Newington is concerned about. And I'm going to read from Article 8 in your regulations. In considering an application for a special permit, the commission shall evaluate the merit of the application with respect to the following factors. 8.1, suitable location, paragraph B. That the harmony and intensity of the use or activity in relation to the size of the lot will be in harmony with the orderly development of the area and compatible with other existing uses. Well, I think the fact that the applicant feels the need, and it's their business, I'm not going to question their business decision, but the fact that they feel the need to put their material in the area of their property that's supposed to be reserved for either lawn or parking is evidence that this business has outgrown the site. It has become too intense for that location. And then finally, item 8.8, 8.9, other considerations, paragraph E, that the use will not have negative impacts on neighboring towns or on the region. And my entire three-page letter summarizes all the different aspects of how this project, if approved, the lack of screening will, in Newington's opinion, have a detrimental impact on the businesses in Newington. And one last thing, I have some additional photographs that I would like to submit for the record, in addition to the three that you already have.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, you want to ask
Sure.
Craig, glad to see you here.
For some reason, I haven't met you all these years. I don't understand why.
I've only been there five years. I'm still a newbie.
Yeah. yeah, you have a property near this that's not coming along too well either. But, yeah, you're absolutely right about the need for some of the things that you're talking about. No question about that. And I think we need to address them, and the applicant certainly needs to. And I would hope that they will do so. Thank you.
You want to ask?
I want to thank you for your observations. Again, if you go down the Berlin Turnpike and the Newington, I don't think we have any landscaping deliverables like this from the Wethersfield line down to the town of Berlin. You have to go to Frank's, and which is set back off the way. I don't think there's anything on Stam Road or Costello Road or any of the industrial parks even that have this type of facility. So
the correct. Intensity not of the you go up on Payne Road quite a distance, correct?
Yeah, it's quite a while. Quite a while since anything like this has been in Newington, never mind even down to Berlin. Got quite a ways. So again, thank you for your comments.
I had another question I couldn't remember when I was giving it to you. Have any of the neighbors on the other side, and those buildings are pretty solid types, have they complained to you at all about this site?
No, they haven't. And my understanding is that, and I wouldn't disagree, but I think Wethersfield's policy is that written notice to abutting property owners stops at the town line. So it's certainly possible they don't even know about the pendency of this application.
Yeah. Understood. One so you're speaking on behalf of them then. That's it.
Yes.
What you think they would do.
That's correct.
Jim?
Thanks for coming. Appreciate it. And I remember a couple of renderings there. One maybe had a gas station, a hotel over time.
Mm-hmm.
What year was the plan you're working on right now? What year was that approved by your town?
Well, that's
the way it is today.
It's complicated. The site plan that I believe I gave you a copy of was approved roughly 9 years ago, and the owner of the property came to TPZ last year and got it extended for a few more years because he was running out of time. The reason he was running out of time was because he was at that point actively recruiting a major active adult developer who was going to build a high-rise, beautiful, state-of-the-art active adult development, which actually did get approved by planning and zoning. So theoretically, there are two approved site plans at the moment for that property. But we haven't heard too much from the active adult developer, so that project doesn't seem like it's gonna work out.
Within 9 years, maybe even a little later, the current. When was the active adult approved?
Just a year and a half ago.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Other questions?
Okay, so do you think the hearing will be kept open?
It would be my
okay.
Yes. Yes.
Good. Then I'll stay in touch with Mr. Gillespie on that.
Very good. Good. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you for entertaining me.
Take it back and tell Newington we do it so much better than they do.
They have the red light, green light, though, which we don't have for big public hearings, so you get so many minutes.
Nice. Nice. DOT gave up on that a long time ago. Any other individuals wishing to speak on this? All right. At this point, unless the applicant has some additional thoughts they want to throw out at us before you do? Okay, come on up.
I'll make it brief. I would like to counter that. So that development was approved roughly 9 years ago, and we've been at our location 17. So we were there in some shape or form before the approval. So, you know, and we haven't tripled in size, we haven't changed the property dimensions, and we haven't changed the core of our business. So that's, to some extent, we're pre-existing, or not to some extent, the truth is we're pre-existing, and we're there, and pallets were there. And, you know, it's our business to sell pallets of material. And we can't see, one of the things that attracts people to that stone yard is the amount of stock that we have, well-stocked shelves. There's a lot going on there. There's a lot of activity there. That lends itself to our prosperity, to our strength. I completed the special criteria, Article 8. I'd like to submit that. Is that possible?
You can, we'll take anything that you care. I don't, not sure I understood what you mean. You completed it.
Well, it's, we addressed the subjects or the, you know.
Oh, you have a response to basically
yes.
what
yes,
Newington has said?
Yep. Yep.
I'd rather have that be part of your actual
okay.
presentation.
Yeah.
So you're hearing the whole thing. And you know, there's enough discussion in Peter's memo of, you know, what you were proved to do in 99, 01, 02, 03, 04, you know, violations in 02, 03, 04, 11. I think it would be...
Sir, with all due respect, we weren't there till 2004.
Okay, so there were only enforcements in 4, 7, 11, 12, and 16 that you're responsible for.
That's true. That's 100% correct.
Okay. The point I was trying to make was that I think it would be useful for you when you come back with the plan to provide the commission with a narrative description of how your business operates there, just so that there isn't some kind of misconception as to, you know, dump trucks coming in and out all day long, you know, versus how many retail customers, you know, that kind of thing. What the actual business activity on a day-to-day basis there is, how it works on the site and so forth, just so that, you know, we understand what it is that's happening with what it is that people see there. Because, you know, if all you hear about is dump trucks and all you see are huge piles, you know, it's you know, maybe everybody has their own interpretation of what your operation is, but I think it'd be good for you to lay it out once and for all, since it has been a moving target over the years.
Okay. Yep. We'll take you up on that advice. Yeah.
So, do I hear a motion?
Second.
Yeah. Motion to continue
April
the
18th?
April 18th, the next meeting.
Yep.
Okay.
Second.
All right. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Is there anybody opposed? All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
See you soon. All righty. The next item on the agenda is once again a public hearing for 1940-17-Z, George Chatsopoulos, and I'll let you correct me.
Well, I'm Jerry Farrell, so I'm not going to attempt to correct that.
Alrighty.
But I believe you have it correct.
All right. Seeking a special permit in accordance with Section 5.8, Alcoholic Beverages, for the Chips Restaurant at 1301 Celestine Highway. So, once again, introduce yourself and
sure.
Your
project. My name is Jerry Farrell, Jr. I'm an attorney in Wallingford. I'm representing the applicant, George Chapoulis. George is the owner of the Chips Restaurant. It's a Connecticut chain of restaurants. There's locations in Orange, Fairfield, Trumbull, Southbury, and, of course, in Wethersfield since 2014. We're here this evening. It's a pancake house and hamburger restaurant. There's a wide variety of menu to it. And we would like to offer wine and beer. We are doing this at the other Chips locations. Some of the clientele for Chips certainly is senior citizens. They like to come for dinner. They're looking for a glass of wine, a glass of beer. There would be no bar involved. There's no spirits being offered, strictly wine and beer. It would be served by wait service staff that the wine and beer would be locked in the kitchen and would be served by the wait staff from the kitchen. The other sites, not high volume. If they go through a couple of cases of wine in a month and a couple of cases of beer in a month, that's a lot for them. But it is an added convenience to the customers here in Wethersfield who want to go out for a nice meal, and they would like to have that one glass of beverage in the evening. The restaurant closes at 10 p.m. in the evening. It's a standalone restaurant in a retail plaza. There's nothing really all that similar in the plaza. I've given you some photos of what the interior of the building looks like, so you have some sense of the flavor. The restaurant wine and beer, at least from the perspective of state liquor licensing, is one of the harder licenses to get because you're required to have hot food available at all times. So you would need to meet that requirement from the state's perspective to have that license. So we're here asking for a special permit that would accommodate this additional offering at the restaurant.
All right. Thank you. Let's start with somebody besides George this time. All right, George.
What wine pairs well with pancakes?
With strawberry.
Yeah,
with strawberry syrup.
Go ahead.
Go ahead, George.
Mr. Chair,
are you going?
Okay. Can I ask Peter if he has any observations? Just to step on George?
Just to refresh your memory, Section 5.8 of your regulations has the provisions regarding permits for alcoholic beverages. The general considerations, unlike other communities, we don't have the, 1,500 foot, 500 foot, 1,000 foot separating distance between, similar activities. You have general language which says specifically that the proximity of the establishment to schools, churches, synagogues, residential neighborhoods, and charitable institutions supported by public or private funds, such that in the judgment of the commission, the trade associated with the establishment does not disrupt the quiet pursuit of education and religion. And then secondly, the proximity of the establishment to another alcoholic beverage establishment such that in the judgment of the commission, there not be created a cluster or undue concentration of establishments where the sale or consumption of alcoholic beverages may be perceived as a dominant characteristic of the neighborhood or that area. So those are the two criteria that you traditionally look at as it relates to the issuance of special permits for this type of an application.
Thank you. Thanks. Yeah, I was going to do that. Does anybody need to see it? George.
Yeah. Did you put new lights in that shopping center at all? I know at your end you got the pavement done. At least the end, I'm sorry. You're representing the owner, right?
Correct, the owner of the restaurant.
And so your pavement around your restaurant there that you're representing was redone when the restaurant went in, I believe.
Yes, I mean, the standalone restaurant is a later addition to that site.
Okay, I'm going to bring up my issue that I brought up before, earlier this year and last year. The paving by the owner and the rest of that shopping center needs to be done. It is falling apart. When you go into Buffalo Wild Wings, other restaurant in that area, it's disgusting in there. And I mentioned it here regarding property to the south that the owner bought, and I'm unhappy that he hasn't gotten the paving, and he's said, well, when we get this done, we do that. It's a put off. And I've seen that over too many years now. And I would like to put a condition in that he paved this year, at least some portion of that that site. And what are the nearest dispensers of what he's interested in?
So in terms of proximity, there are a couple of establishments within the shopping center. You've got Ginza. You've got the Buffalo Wild Wings, as you mentioned. You've got a pizza restaurant. And then you have across the street. Well, Red Lobster is a little, it's sort of diagonally. But
Denny's?
Yeah, I don't think Denny's has a...
No, it's BYO.
This doesn't show any distances, right?
No, we don't have specific provisions for distances. So there are, in terms of places of worship...
does the noodle place have
it? Is the ramen place, is it going to have one?
He is going to have it when he does open. You did give him approval for that location.
But I still don't think that turns it into a
I think, I think those, when they're talking about the characteristics, they're talking about more of a, nightclub, where you've got a cluster of those kinds of, businesses which can create a certain atmosphere. This is not the kind of permit that one would consider in those criteria. So
his point is it's a very light dispensing of...
Yes.
The only other point I make, did he meet the four requirements in here or whatever they are in the previous?
Those conditions had to do with the original application, which has since been given a certificate of occupancy and closed out.
Exterior lighting is all good for that?
Yes.
One
up. George, to your issue with the pavement, obviously, I think putting that burden on this permit where they have no say over that is probably not the most appropriate. Your zoning officer is here in the audience. We do have requirements that property owners maintain their property. So I think with him hearing your concern, he will take it under advisement and investigate the situation. And they do have an obligation, even if they don't repave it, to make it safe and to not have a deteriorating condition.
It really is.
And we have talked to him about that. So I think he's been waiting for the weather, obviously, to break. So, hopefully, you will see that work.
Even if he doesn't do it all, I mean, he only has about 2/3 of it to do, a half or something. I mean, it's done.
I agree with Peter. I think it's very unreasonable to try to.
I agree with you, James. But the point is, so we keep putting it off and putting it off.
It has nothing to do with this application, in my opinion.
He probably has, in his lease, he probably has no control over that anyway. That's an owner's. He's leasing the property. He probably doesn't even have the right to do it. He may not have the right to.
He probably doesn't. That's not what I'm suggesting. I think he has to go back to the owner of the property and as a tenant here and say, I would like to see some of the pavement done there. It's unsafe for the people in there.
But it's not
they
even
do use that northern part sometimes. I know when they've had good crowds in there on, say, a Sunday or something.
We'll make the suggestion.
But I'll lay off of this thing, Peter, once more. And I hope this some guy doesn't get stuck in a pothole out there in that parking lot.
You've got as I said earlier, your zoning officer is present and will, I see him nodding his head in agreement with you. He will be following up.
An official complaint from me.
So there any other?
Peter, seeing George is satisfied now, there are no conditions with this. It would be a special permit.
It's a special permit. It runs with the land. So, the next, if God forbid Chips wasn't in business in the near future, and another restaurant wanted to go in there, they could go through the state process to get the permit switched over. But nevertheless, from our perspective, that business has a restaurant, beer and wine. So. They wouldn't necessarily have to come back. So that's the only thing I want you to be aware of.
Have you made a preliminary check with the state liquor control about this?
Well, my practice is pretty much exclusively liquor licensing. So clients approach me and I vet the application and I don't see any problem with them getting this license, but it has to be vetted. You might be interested to know that every liquor license is renewable annually. And if there is some issue, it can be done in on an annual basis. That the remonstrance procedure, which most people think just pertains to a new application, pertains to every renewal. So if it became a problem site, you have the ability to go to the state and ask that the license not be renewed. Most people aren't aware of that.
So I was going to actually ask Peter, just because I don't think it necessarily, weighs on this application. It's just numerically, I thought there was a numerical limit.
For package stores.
Is that what it is? So it's just package stores only?
It's based on population.
Yeah, okay.
Is there any difference between, you know, beer and wine selling bottles, like single bottles, to another organization that would come in potentially and have like a full working bar? Like, is there a difference?
I can answer that. I mean, the permit itself is a restaurant. Has to be a restaurant. If you wanted to get a full liquor permit, a cafe permit, or something of that nature, it's different. If we limit it to a restaurant license, it means they have to have a restaurant license, which is a particular category with liquor control. I also practice in that area. And therefore, you have to have at least 5 or 6 hot meals at any time, which they have, you know, more than that. So you're not going to get a bar with a restaurant permit as compared to, say, a cafe permit.
And every new liquor application requires local zoning signatures. So if somebody new comes in, they're going to have to go get town clerk, town planner, and fire marshal to sign off on the location all anew.
But if we can't limit it to just beer and wine, if by calling it a restaurant,
that's what it is.
It's a restaurant, and that's beer, wine and that's wine beer and beer. Only. That's specifically what they've asked for. Okay. Nothing else. That's what we're issuing. So if you wanted to change it to a different type of liquor, they'd have to come back. As far as I'm concerned.
Okay.
Coliseum.
That answers my question. Since they're not having a bar, if a new person buys it, they have to come to us if they want to put a bar in there.
If they want to change the liquor permit,
we are limiting his use. It's all coming from the kitchen or from.
We're limiting it to a restaurant, okay. Beer and wine.
Yeah. All right. Interesting. Okay. Learn something. We learn something new every time. It is a public hearing. It is a public hearing. Now, is there anybody here who wishes to speak on the application, Mister? I'm wearing a Chips, you know, fleece. So it is a hearing. Motion on the hearing.
Motion to close.
Second.
And George second. Thank you very much. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
I make a motion to approve this application, Mr. Chairman.
Seconds.
Very good. This is no criteria, right? In this application 1940-17-Z. No conditions, right? All right.
Don't normally put time frames on, huh?
Nope. All right. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Anyone opposed? Passes unanimously. Good luck.
Thank you very much.
I don't ever remember seeing Chips with that few people in the, as purported by those pictures. Like, I can't even get through the door when I'm looking to go there. All right.
This meeting's making me hungry.
So we have minutes from March 21st. George?
Fine. I make a motion to approve. There's one thing that I'd like to note that was not put within the minutes. Under my questioning of Rusty or the architect, he did state that.
What page are you on?
Yeah, is there a page?
What page?
What page?
What page are you on?
On page 3.
Thank you.
Twice I had, I know him as Rusty, but the architect state that the acoustical panels and their locations would be designed, or an acoustical engineer would be involved in the designing and the placement of them on the building. I just want that somewhere in the minutes so that he is controlled with that.
He didn't say that in here? Did you read it?
Under my statement, just said I was concerned with the noise factor, but I know twice I asked that question to him when he said that an acoustical engineer was on job and they would be involved with the specification and the placement of the panels.
We certainly didn't discuss, we did discuss it. We certainly didn't require that they do an analysis or like a pre and post.
He's simply saying that a question was raised, did they have an, I think it was mentioned.
Is that all it was, or were you saying that, you know, twice you said that you will not have one? What were you?
That he had an acoustical engineer and that the acoustical engineer would be involved in the specification and the placement of the panels.
Here it is, up top of page 6. Mr. Rustman is saying there was an acoustical engineer as part of our team.
I thought the sound abatement, like, qualities of the wall were just sort of ancillary to this.
Yeah, I want to make sure the minutes don't suggest that we told them they need a noise study.
That's what I'm saying, is that it was just sort of an added benefit that they had sound.
They made them as with acoustical
qualities,
characteristics, yeah.
Yeah, because, I mean, that kind of was
Does that
one
mean
of the reasons
what
why
you
I thought they would be a good thing to
that?
Have
right.
extended.
Right.
Only a one-liner, but it says discussion ensued, so I don't know.
Fine. Are you comfortable with that reference to it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Dave? Okay. All right, so George, did you make a motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Thank you, Rich. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? I do note that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Right.
At least two of the folks of the eight, so we can only have six positives, right? Dave, Ryan, George, Rich, myself. Is it five? Three are not here.
Dan.
Oh, and Dan. So Dan, Dave, Ryan, George, Rich, and myself, six.
Good.
Enough.
All right. We did take the vote, right? Okay.
Next item.
So we have the report from Justin, an update. Did you want to comment on it, or shall we just...
Would you like to approach?
Color coding. Very
nice. Yeah, I like the color code.
Anything additional you'd like to offer?
If you have questions, I'm here.
We'll just call you.
Just give me a call. Anytime.
Perfect.
We'll leave a note on a tree in the right of way.
I'll find it.
All right.
Or attach it to a chicken that's roaming.
I was going
to
say, I don't
it might
see
be
as
more,
many chickens.
More exciting.
It's winter.
If chickens, it's died down. It'll right. probably be hatching up real soon.
Yeah.
So Peter has given us a couple pieces of paper. One is the 5-year capital plan, which I guess we'll speak to. Or discuss.
It'll be on your next agenda for action.
It's dated today. So
if you have any questions on that in the interim that we can prepare and address in advance, please let us know. That was the purpose of giving it out tonight.
Peter, do they ever list the specific streets that are on the agenda for the short-term and long-term?
For paving? They do develop the lists. It depends on the time of year, but I can...
I go online once in a while to see what's... Into the town.
I don't know why they don't put them on there.
He'll
need it there.
I'm sure they could once they establish the list. It's just maybe not been the practice, but Derek Gregor will be at your next meeting, so you should.
I think that there were like 8 of them on the council agenda for last night for mill and overlay.
Yep.
There were like 8 different streets, I think, were this year's.
But
project.
Peter, I'm serious. You might suggest that he definitely do that because I have to go.
Yeah, it's good information. Yeah, it's good information.
Please,
yeah,
right?
It's easy.
Yeah.
We are converting Cumberland Avenue into a cul-de-sac. I just if that was the question.
Speed bumps. What?
Speed bumps on
speed
both
bumps?
Ends.
Different kinds of vegetative mulch and
chips
byproducts.
Oh, there we go.
Millings. So.
It's going to be a neon sign, one of those digital signs demo areas.
I'd like some acoustic tile myself.
So on a similar personal note, I saw some X's on sidewalks in my neighborhood. When are you going to hit my street? Huh. My side of the street?
You got some deficient sidewalks on yours? You want me to send my...
I assume I'll get an X or two when they come around to my sidewalk.
You don't want the X's.
I know.
You don't want the X's.
I just need to financially plan for such.
Mm-hmm.
Bond for it.
You gave us a proposed zone amendment coming from Newington.
Newington, just a report from CROG. Apparently they are amending their regulations to eliminate temporary signs from the zoning regulations. So if you...
I'd like you to write a 5-page memo and go to their planning and zoning commission meeting talking about how that will adversely...
Strenuously object.
Bring photos.
Oh my God.
All right.
I will remind you for the record, we are on local cable TV. Just
yeah, but it's local.
Okay.
Doesn't right. cross the town
other
boundary.
Staff reports.
We have both of the multifamily applications, the one for the clearinghouse on Church Street and the Fun Zone site, are now actively being reviewed by design review, wetlands. So those will appear in front of you, I think, in May. So we're doing the reviews of both of those right now. So that's going to be heating up rather quickly. There's a couple of other applications that are also getting filed. So as I mentioned at a couple of meetings ago, you're going to have some. We're trying to stagger them so they're none of them happen the same night, but it's going to be close. So we'll do what we can to try and spread those out a little bit. But nevertheless, those are on the very near horizon.
Yeah. I hear the Fun Zone has some changes.
Fun Zone presented revised plans to us. The density has come down in terms of, I think it was originally 120 units, so it's now closer to 100 units. They made some changes to the location. They've moved the building closer to the street. If you remember, there was some parking in the front. They're trying to minimize the fills in the flood zone. So they've made those kinds of, they've added a rooftop deck to the building.
Bigger units?
Some bigger units, more two bedrooms, and a couple of three bedrooms, which I don't think was in the original mix. They're targeting, you know, a divorced, you know, someone who's been through divorce who wants to have the kids, you know, come and they have extra rooms for them, that kind of thing. So
was a retail proposal in the lower part?
There's still a restaurant. Still, yeah, they are still proposing the retail. They have to because of the mixed use requirements of the zoning regulations. So they're still talking about a restaurant. And they're talking about two or three other retail spaces on the ground level.
Economic development director, you really feel that can be utilized well, or they can promote?
I think they already have the tenants lined up. So, yeah, it's not a lot. It's not a lot of commercial space, and it is a pretty. It is the trend for these types of buildings. You've got a built-in population in the building. So,
It's not the building. It's being down.
It's not going to be down. It's going to be up at that point.
Yeah. Up enough so people will see it.
Yes.
It'll be visible. Okay, that's all I'm asking.
Yes.
Because City Fish still with their sign still has an issue. The sign is down to some degree.
Which property?
Slope off. Yeah, I'm just simply saying, from an economic point of view, the places that can be seen,
sure.
Retail wise, are in demand.
Developers risk.
That's right.
Towers. All
other. Topics for us?
Motion opposed.
Thank you. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
What would you say?
Can I? Yes. No.